Will I ever get married?
Should we move in together?
How can I focus on God while dating? Why do I feel so alone?
Are looks really that important? Is sex really such a big deal? You may have a lot of questions about your walk with God. So let's talk about it. Hello and welcome to another episode of L'Amour in Christ. I'm Kaitia L'Amour and today we're going to be talking about marriage, specifically things that I learned in marriage. Me and my husband just recently celebrated our 9th anniversary in San Diego on September 12th, so I will link that here because I asked you guys if you wanted to know what I learned, like 9 things I learned in 9 years, so I'm finally sitting down to make that video, and it's gonna be a good one. If you plan to get married, if you are married, whatever your age is, whatever your situation, I think that some of these things I learned will help you. It's definitely been something that has been brought up in conversation between my single friends and my married friends, and it's been helpful to them. So let's get into 9 things I've learned about marriage in 9 years, specifically a God-centered Christian marriage. That's where I'm coming from, that's my perspective, so that's where these are going to fall in line with. Also, these are listed in no particular order. I was just jotting down 9 things and I thought that they would be helpful, so it's not like this is the most important to the least important or anything. It's just that all of these are important, but in no particular order is how I'm speaking them. So in no particular order, here comes number 1. So something that you hear a lot is, oh, a family that prays together stays together. And part of that is true, but the main big picture thing is a family that serves the Lord together stays together. There are plenty of couples who pray. They're like, we pray in the morning, we pray at night. Why do we have so many issues? Or what's happening to our relationship? But it's really understanding that you guys are purpose mates. I don't know if you've heard this. I've heard it a few times from a few different ministers that marriage is a responsibility, and it's also two people coming together to pursue their calling in Christ. And when we are doing things together, obviously it's better to have someone who's got your back, who has a similar vision in life and a similar desire to serve and please the Lord. So not only should you pray together, you should also be thinking about how do we, specifically our family, our marriage, serve the Lord together. So that's prayer, that's studying the word, that's desiring an intimate relationship with God. I've talked about how I learned to hear God's voice more clearly. I will link that here. And my husband has also strengthened his ability to hear the Lord clearly. So we can be in agreement. Major decisions in life, we can know, okay, we sought the Lord. This is what he needs us to do, because I'm telling you, there have been years, my newlywed years, where we were just kind of trying to figure out everything on our own. It wasn't until we submitted our purpose and future to the Lord as a couple that we started to get into a groove of, okay, God, we know where you're leading us, and we're on one accord, and we both understand where this is headed. So a family that serves the Lord together will stay together. A family that is committed to being on one accord and serving the Lord together, that family, they're gonna have each other's back, and they're gonna make sure that they are doing what God calls them to do. And that is a very, 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 very important part of the marriage, the way that God designed it to be, which is under his leadership and his will and his guidance and direction and protection and all of that. So let's get into number 2. Number 2 is communication. We all understand that communication is great. It's an important part of any relationship, but how many of you know that literally communication can make or break your relationship, your marriage? And I had to learn this the hard way. A lot of these things that I'm sharing with you are because I learned it the hard way, so don't do what I did. Take these things to heart. It wasn't until a few years into marriage, we actually went through this course called Couple Talk, and we were part of the DVD series, so they basically talk about communication between husband and wife, and we learned some vital things about listening, like really listening and not thinking about, okay, this argument, I'm gonna win, I wanna be right, I wanna make sure that my point comes across. It's, are you really listening? Are you communicating effectively to get your point across? Are you saying things when you're angry, or are you allowing yourself to say, you know what, give me 30 minutes, I need to cool down, I need to get my thoughts together because I don't wanna say something that I regret, because you cannot take it back. And so for me and my husband, it's definitely been a thing. We're not just talking at each other, but are we getting to the root of the issue? are we really understanding it? So even if he tells me I have an issue with this, or if I tell him I have an issue with this, then sometimes we'll have to talk for like an hour or so to say, okay, so when I say this or when I do this, this is why you feel this way. Okay, this is where this is rooted in. Okay, now I understand, don't approach you like this. Or you understand, hey, I'm not attacking you, or I'm not like this other person in your life who's done this to you. So it's more about understanding each other's communication styles and wanting to make sure that they feel loved in conversation and heard in conversation and respected in conversation. So that's something that I've learned, because I know people specifically where their communication is so on point, and it's like, wow, everything around that is nourished. Their whole relationship is nourished because they take that time to make sure that they're communicating well. And I've seen other marriages where it's like all the other things make sense. You love the Lord, you love your family, you're working hard, but your communication is tearing you guys apart. So if you have poor communication, maybe you need to have counseling, maybe you need to have a mediator literally translate, you know, what you guys are saying to each other, because that's kind of what happened to us in the couple talk series. Was we're saying things and it's like someone else almost has to come through and clear out that filter, because there can sometimes be a wall and a filter where it's like, no matter what you say right now, it comes through as criticism. No matter what you say right now, it comes through as judgment. So getting to the root of like, hey, we love each other, we want to build each other up, how can we say things in a way that's going to be effective? And that's something that has changed the game. I feel like this should be instituted. I don't know if it is anywhere or any church or any program, but I do feel like every couple in their newlywed stage should probably see a counselor, a therapist, or have some person, a mentor or a couple that they admire, or even a parent or some elder or somebody helping them to communicate. Because man, psh, 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 my newlywed stage, my first couple years was struggle city with communication, and we probably could have used a lot of help or listened more or taken it more seriously when people did say, hey, if you keep doing this, you're probably not gonna end up going down the right road, you might get sidetracked, or you might just build up resentment. Now we know. So I hope you take that seriously, that yes, communication is vital, one of the most vital things, healthy, effective communication in a marriage. Number three, speaking of newlywed phase, happy ever after, some people do have that, oh my gosh, I found the love of my life, this is great, our newlywed stage was so beautiful, it was seamless. Not everybody has that, so don't compare yourself to other couples that have had the best day ever, the best years ever. It wasn't like that, especially for me and my husband coming from a long distance dating relationship to now we're moved in because we're married and now I'm seeing you all the time, and like, what do we do? Like, it just felt very chaotic and we didn't really understand why things were so hard. And a lot of things that you kind of unpack and resolve in person weren't things that we were able to do because we were apart for our whole dating relationship, and even some of our marriage, a few months of our marriage as I was moving from Hawaii to California. So that made it a lot harder for us, and I remember thinking, this is so hard. Like, what have I done? This is really hard. I thought it was gonna be really easy. I thought it was gonna be like, a lot of my problems are solved, my life is so blissful. But you're two imperfect people coming together, and especially if you haven't had the time or the ability to work through a lot of things beforehand, you're just gonna have to work through that in your newlywed stage. But if you are two committed people, and my mom says this a lot, two committed people who want a healthy, God-centered marriage and are willing to do the work, it will work for you. And that's why I'm so glad that I submitted my husband to the Lord when I was just single, didn't even meet my husband yet. I made the conscious decision to say, God, I'm not dating until you bring my husband to me. And I want it to be clear that it's you who brought him to me, because now when we're going through stuff in our newlywed phase, or even 9 years later, I'm like, you know what, we can get through this. If God brought us together, if I know that God brought us together, which I do know that, and my husband knows that, we're committed to doing what it takes to make it work. Even when there's been really dark times where I'm like, this is real hard and I don't know how we're gonna get through this, but by God's grace, submitting ourselves to him, getting the right kind of feedback and counseling and stuff, that really did help us a lot in our newlywed phase up until now. And by the way, if you hear noises, it's dogs. We actually are helping our sister move into her new home, so that's why my background looks a little bit different, and that's why the sound may be a little bit different. It's because we're in a house that is still being put together and she has dogs, and so if you hear that, that's what that is. don't mind it. Okay, so we're moving on to number four. This was a profound thing that I learned. Going to church, it was like a marriage talk. Once a month, I think the pastor and the first lady would come and they would talk about marriage, they would answer questions. It was kind of like a Q&A for relationships, especially Christian relationships, because it was at church. But one of the things that someone said that I heard it before, but I guess I didn't know how serious it was. Like, someone talked about like the order of family, and basically they were talking about how there's God, who's first, then it's marriage, and then it's kids. And what I kind of thought, because you see this a lot, is like once you have kids, your life is over, and it's all about them, it revolves around them, blah, blah, blah. But I know that my parents didn't really feel that way. My parents had said like, hey, they came into my life. Like, they're gonna be a part of this vision and this plan. I'm still gonna take care of them and everything, but my life does not revolve around my kids. But I didn't really hear that a lot in society and even in church a lot. It was just like, my kids are my everything, you know, and if they're okay, then we're okay. But honestly, I take that very seriously now, because people get offended by that. But if your household is in disorder, it's going to affect your kids very negatively. So if all of your time is being poured into them, you're having marriage problems, you're not taking care of each other, you're not talking as much as you used to, you're not communicating as well, you're frustrated, maybe you're tired, you're exhausted maybe. But if you take time to refresh each other and to remember like, hey, we got married for a reason, we are gonna be together forever, our kids will grow up, they'll move out, they'll have their spouses, they'll have their kids. But for us, like, this is a lifelong commitment that we made. So making sure that your marriage is a priority after God, God first, then marriage, then kids, making sure of that, like, that's helped me and my husband so much, because it can get to some sort of like whirlwind when you have a child who's dependent on you, and sometimes you just feel like you're trying to survive. And whenever you get into that mode, you have to remember, like, God didn't come here, he didn't send his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross so that we can just survive. He said that we would be blessed. He said that we'd be prosperous. He said we'd have peace. He said we'd have joy. He said we'd have an abundance of things, of blessings from him. So if he wanted us to just survive, yeah, okay, sure, put your kids first, put your job first, put church first, but no, he wants us to have a blessed union in marriage, a blessed family. It's just supposed to be a very beautiful thing, a thing that refreshes you and builds you up, and not something that tears you down or may just like pummels you into the ground. So that's something that I've learned for myself, and it's been very helpful to me to understand that I need to care about my husband. He needs to care about me and my needs, and making sure that we're a team together raising our family. And number five, speaking of how I talked about before, allowing God to choose my spouse for me, that was a very important thing to me, so that I could continue to realize, okay, if God brought us together, he's gonna help us through these hard times. But not just about hard times, when you allow God to choose your spouse for you, he knows what you will need when you're 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. I got married at 23, my husband was 30, and something that I keep seeing year after year is like new reasons why we got married. Like, oh my gosh, like, this was totally God, because he knew I need a husband like this, I need the father of my children to be like this, I need someone to support my ministry like this, I need someone to support my career like this. It's just like blows my mind how beautiful he's made our marriage to be through the good and the bad times. Like, through the bad times, understanding that my husband will never leave me, he's not just gonna walk out and do his own thing, he's going to be a man of integrity, a man who's intentional about seeking the Lord. And that helps me to feel more secure and more protected and more covered. And that's something that we both had to grow in, coming from being young single people to like, oh, we have a life, we have bills, we have job, we have stuff that we need to do. We're continuing to see, oh my goodness, like, this is why our careers are like this, this is why our ministries go like this, like, everything is hand in hand, like, everything we do, we're just like, wow, I didn't know when we got married that we were going to be entrepreneurs. I didn't know that we were going to build up businesses together. I didn't know that we're going to be able to work from home and raise our daughter together. For me, like, that's something that I feel God purposed in me to do, and that's a desire he placed in me. So now that it's being realized, I'm like, oh yeah, that makes sense. So allow God to choose your spouse, because you don't really know, because you didn't create yourself. We have a creator who created us and put certain things in us for our purpose and our calling here in life, and he knows who needs to be brought together. Speaking of that, I don't necessarily believe in like the one, like, I use that because it's a common term, like, oh, I found the one, my spouse is the one. I think that there are a few people on earth that you could have a very healthy, God-centered marriage, they need certain things in them that would work with your certain things. So I don't say like my husband is like the one person in the entire universe I could have had a healthy marriage with, but because of my life decisions and where I was, his life decisions, where he was, what he built himself up to be, how he sought the Lord, how I sought the Lord, I think through time, like, this is the person, while I was ready to be married, who I needed to meet, where I needed to be, like, all of that. I hope that makes sense. So I'm not saying he's the worst or the best or anything. I'm just saying he's the person that God called me to marry, and I know that for sure because I sought him in that. But if for some reason he in life made a decision to be with somebody else, it wouldn't be like, I'm single forever because my one person chose somebody else. That's something I was thinking about, and that's why I said it. So that's the end of that one. So the next tip and advice and lesson learned was that it does take two committed people to make a marriage work. It can only take one person to ruin it. My mom has told me that before, like, it takes two people to make a great marriage work. It can only take one people or both people to ruin it. For us being committed and understanding that divorce isn't something we ever wanted, a healthy marriage is what we were working toward. It made us make certain decisions, and it made us not make certain decisions based on, do I want to respect my spouse? Do I want to make sure that they feel loved? Do I want to make sure that we're growing in God together? And that comes with like work or goals or like whatever. If you set something in your mind where you're like, this is the ultimate goal, this is what I want, what choices am I going to make to achieve that? So if I want the type of marriage God wants for me, both of us are deciding, this is what we're going to do. This is how God calls husbands to be. This is how God calls wives to be. This is how God calls just Christians in general to be. Are we going to do that? Are we going to follow his will day after day? Though we are not perfect, that's something that we have been pursuing since we have gotten married. And I think that's a big part of why we're able to make it through some really, really hard times in our marriage and just continue to get over them and be stronger through that and not allow it to weaken us and devastate us and be like, you know, I don't want to do this anymore because this is too hard. No matter what, any relationship you're going to be in, there's going to be times where you're just like, this is too hard. I don't want to do this anymore. But then God will renew your strength and he will help you to make sure that you're able to stay committed and to get through the trials that will come, because he's already overcome the world. He will help you to know what to do to overcome some things in your marriage and in your personal life. And speaking of life in general and pursuing God in life, the next thing I learned was not to lose myself in my marriage or in parenting, because when you're a single person, you kind of know it's kind of all about you for the most part. You may still have friends and family and work and stuff, but day after day, you're mostly thinking about what you need to do. Especially for me, before I got married, I was just like, God is calling me to do this. I'm hearing his voice so clear. Everything's making sense. It's all coming together. And once I got married, I lost myself a little bit. Like, okay, I'm considering someone else. All right, they communicate a little differently. Our goals and plans are a little bit different, but we still support each other. But it just seemed like it rocked my world, especially leaving Hawaii, coming to California, and it's like new town, new people, who dis? So for me, I just had to realize after time, and this took years to kind of get back on track with what God had been calling me to do since I was single. So that happened again when I had a daughter. I'm like, what do I do? Like, now I have a baby, I'm taking care of her, I want my attention to go to her, I want to make sure she's safe, but I just kind of felt like, what do I even like to do anymore? And who do I want to hang around? And what is my career now that I'm a stay-at-home mom and I'm going to be homeschooling? And just so many things came up where I just felt kind of like, whoa, like, what do I do? And even through that, thank God, through that time after having a daughter, it made me recalibrate. And I was like, you know what? What do I want in life? Like, what did God call me to do in life? What does it take to pursue him right now? And I just really recalibrated everything. Me and my husband talked about this in our live Q&A about keeping faith in hard times. I will link that above. Going through rough seasons and new changes and just really big life-altering moments, it kind of forces you. Well, it forced us, because we wanted what God wanted for us. It forced us to really reassess everything about our life and get back to the basics about our relationship and parenting, and definitely just putting God back in the first place where he should have been all along, and saying, God, what do you want? What is this? What do you want to happen from this? And from there, it's just been so great. It was really hard resetting the foundation and kind of feeling like everything was falling apart. But now where we are, we're at peace with knowing where God needs us to be. And I just talked about that in my video about understanding my purpose and finding success, and I'll link that too because that has such a big part of like our personal relationship with God. Me and my husband had to really seek the Lord, like, what do we need to do right now? Because you've given us big dreams, big desires, big goals that we hadn't even had for ourselves. But after seeking you, we understood like, whoa, this is a bigger deal than we thought it was. So what do we need to do to get there? Instead of like us having our goals for the year, it's like, God, what are your goals for us? And then, oh my gosh, how do we get there? Because that seems really big and really too much. Like, how is that gonna happen? Now we understand that our identity is in God, and no matter what season we go through, no matter what responsibility and hat we're wearing, God has to be first, and make sure that you don't lose sight of what this whole reason behind living life really is, because we can get caught up in our to-do list and really forget that there's a bigger picture and a bigger plan and people depending on our obedience and the blessings that come from that. So that made me think more about my personal life and what I needed to do. And speaking of that, the next tip is focusing on your life and not comparing it to other people, because you can see, oh man, this person got this job promotion, this person got a house, this person has a baby, this person is married, and it taints your view and perception of where you should be in life. Because I remember thinking that at a certain age, it seemed like everybody's having babies, or everybody's doing this, everybody's buying houses, everybody got cars. God just had to check in and tell me like, hey, seek me for what you need. And make sure that you're doing what I need you to do. But also, don't compare yourself. Don't compare your spiritual walk. Don't compare your maturity. Don't compare anything to other people, because only God knows who you need to be, where you need to be, what you need to be doing. So by comparison, even on TV shows, like reality TV or movies, you may think like, man, they have it all together. This is what life is like. This is what happiness is for. This is how you get that. But only God knows where your joy, where your happiness, where your peace comes from. And it's from Him, and it's from following His purpose for you and saying yes to His calling for you. And I had to realize that many times after looking at other people and just feeling like really bad about what I did or didn't have. And then it's like, okay, well, if you want those things, are you doing what it takes to get those things? Are you doing what it takes to be in line with God's will so He can bless you? And there's some things I just had to learn about myself that I was just doing wrong. And now where I'm at, I may not have what other people have right now, but I understand it's only in due time and it's only in due season. And at the end of the day, I have Jesus for eternity, so I don't have to feel like bad that things are taking a little bit longer or certain things just didn't happen for me. It just is what it is. So I had to find my contentment and my joy in God, and I hope that you guys understand that too. Like, no matter what season and chapter you're in, find your contentment and your purpose and your calling and your vision from God, to make sure that you're not using other people as a litmus test or allowing them to tell you like, you should be in school, you should be doing this, you should be doing this. It's like, oh, how about you pray about it? And how about you let God tell you what you need to be doing, because He knows where that's gonna lead you and what connections and opportunities and things are gonna happen from that obedience. And His track is a lot faster than the world's track. He can promote you in a way that you never thought possible, in a timing that you never thought possible. And I'm discovering that right now too, which is super exciting. So that was a very vital lesson that I needed to learn in life, was to stop comparing myself or my marriage or my family or my finances or anything to what other people are doing. The last thing that I learned that I'll share with you today, there's a lot of things I learned, but I'm sharing 9 because it said I was going to share 9. But the last thing that I will share today, speaking of comparison, it may seem like everybody else is doing great and you are not. In the hard times, there have been instances where I told my husband like, hey, everybody's doing this or this person doing that. Why can't you just get it together? Why can't you just fix it? Why can't you just figure it out? If you prayed harder, like you would just know. And it just made me build up resentment and bitterness against him. And a lot of people can say that hard times in finances or hard time in raising kids or like tragedy can really cause marriages to fall apart if you allow that to happen. And for me, I never really wanted that to, but I was almost doing that to myself by just being angry and frustrated and just trying to fix it like you fix it, and even pointing the finger and blaming him for things. So you have to allow the hard times that you go through to draw you closer to God, which will draw you both together, because you're both going like this to get to God. So you're automatically going to get closer together, and you're going to understand, okay, this is what we need to do in order for this to be resolved. Whether it's letting go of people, letting go of ideals, letting go of certain certain things that you have in your schedule or starting to build integrity or doing more of the things that you're not doing. But only God knows what the solution is, so you have to seek Him in that and not like fight each other. You have to fight the enemy together, and you probably heard that before. But the things that I'm telling you, you probably heard before, but I'm just confirming that they're real. Like, these are real things that you need to consider and do if you want a healthy and mature God-centered relationship. So yes, seek God. Rely on God. Surrender to God in everything that you do. And you guys can make it through like anything. You'd be surprised the kind of things that long-lasting marriages have been through. Death, adultery, poverty, sickness. Like, you can make it through anything. Like, you really can make it through anything if the two people involved in the marriage are going to do what it takes to make it work and to have a healthy relationship. Like, you really can make it through a lot of stuff. And take it from me, like, there's some things I'll probably tell you guys in the future on different videos, because it would just take too long to talk about it all. But there will be some things that I'll probably tell you guys that we've been through, and it's helped to strengthen our marriage over time, because it just hasn't been perfect and no relationship is. So those are the 9 things that we've learned in our marriage, specifically me, that God has taught me in my marriage. So I wanted to pray for you guys, because you may be single. You may be single, you may be engaged, you may be married, you may even be recently divorced, but I just want to pray for you that you just don't lose that hope that you can have a God-centered, healthy, thriving, prosperous relationship. So let's pray about that. Lord, I just thank you that you have someone for us. If we have that desire for a spouse and to have a family with them in the future, or that you just turn around our relationship or bring us a new relationship or heal our hearts, you are faithful to do that. So I pray for everybody here who's here today. They apparently care about relationships and having a healthy marriage and wanting it to be God-centered. So I just pray that you help them, Lord, even in this time. Show them the areas that they need to work on. Show them the things first that they need to change, even in their walk with you, in their day-to-day life. Help them to know what they need in order to have the things that they desire, Lord. And I just pray that you help to heal the brokenness, heal the wounds. Maybe they've been divorced, or their parents have been divorced, or nobody wants to date them. They just feel very alone. Or their marriage is just going through some times that they're like, I just want out of this. It's never gonna work, but I know that God brought us together. I just don't know how this is gonna make it. So I just pray that you help them to get through this season and to continue to have hope and joy and believe that you will do things for them. And it's not just for everyone else, it's for them too. But please renew their strength. Please renew their desire. Please just refresh their spirit, so that they can really believe that you're there and know what to do in order to meet you there. Because faith without works is dead. So you want us to walk with you and do what we need to do to get the things that we're believing for. So I just pray that everything that they needed to hear out of this, that it will resonate, that it will be planted firmly in their hearts, and that it will do what it's supposed to do and bloom into what it needs to, Lord God. And I pray all this in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. So that's all I have for today. Thanks so much for watching this video. If it did help you in some way, please share it. And you can even like and comment and tell me what was your most helpful tip that I shared. And also, if you like videos like this, I am here every Sunday. I'm sharing about my faith and my testimony and what God is doing in my life. But also on Wednesdays, I post more about lifestyle, parenting, hair, makeup, beauty, fashion, and all of that kind of thing. So Wednesdays and Sundays, I'm here. I'd love to see you back here again. And if you want to partner up with my ministry, I do have t-shirts for sale. I'm wearing one of them right now. All my Sunday videos, I wear my merchandise. So you can click on the link below and buy one of my shirts, or you can even donate. I have a secure link through PayPal where you can send any amount. And I also really appreciate your kind comments and your emails and your likes and your shares and just the fact that you're here. So if you want to see more like this, you can subscribe to my channel, but also don't forget to turn on the notification bell so that you know exactly when I post and that you don't miss a beat. All right, I will see you in my next video. Bye-bye.
Are we recording? Yes, we are.
Hello.
Can you see me? Am I in focus? No, I'm not. Rock-a-doo and rock-a-doo and rock-a-doo.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Oh, what happened? What happened in 5 seconds?
Wow.
Do what you're supposed to do. Act right.
Let me clip my nose.
Yeah.
Is my head cut off this whole time?
Oh my God.
L'Amour in Christ now has apparel. Please check the description box for more information on how to purchase. If you like what you see here, please subscribe. Also, don't forget to check out our previous uploads. See you next time.